church. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Come on. Yeah. When the night has fallen, when fear is coming, still you're calling me. When faith is lost, my hope exhausted, you will be my strength. When my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. I've decided I'm not giving up. You won't give up on me. You won't give up on me. Your love is holding on and you won't let go. Hey.
Oh, you're worthy of all of it. Your promises never fail. I've got stories I live to tell. So I'll come on, he's worthy of our praise. God, you're worthy. We worship you, Lord. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Word, can you just sing that from your heart today? Lift it up and tell him, sing, worthy is your name.
Sacrifices, holy and acceptable. This is our reasonable service of worship to you. We sing
to worship you. I live to worship you. I live to worship you. To worship you. To worship you, I live to worship you. Nothing else matters, nothing else matters. To worship you, sing your heart. I live to worship you. Father, hear your people cry. To worship you, to worship you. I live to worship you.
Let your heart unfold before him and cry, say, cry out, say, oh, 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 oh. Like one big choir to you, Father, we sing, to worship you, I live.
Yeah.
matters. Oh, to worship. I live to worship you. See, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. I tried a lot of things, yes, but Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves around you, Jesus. Sing, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Your heart cry, let your soul cry. Sometimes we can't find the words, but our soul knows what to say. Oh, oh, oh.
Forgiveness flows from hands and feet as violence meets the Prince of Peace. Behold the King, Light of the World, Lamb that was slain, Lion who rose, He's my
sure. Come on, put your hands together again, will you? Thank you, Jesus. If you would, just hold both hands up into the Lord. I want to speak a blessing into your life. In the name of the Lord, every single hand that's open, would you begin to fill it now? Fill it with blessings, Lord. Whatever needs they have, begin to bless them. Exceed their expectations. Those who need a healing in their body, Lord, begin to heal them right now in Jesus' name. For every person who's being tormented with fear, worry, condemnation, in the name of Jesus, Satan, we rebuke you. Leave this room now in Jesus' name. Do not wait for them outside this door. You cannot touch them. There is a hedge of protection around them. There is a ring of fire around them. You cannot touch them. You cannot touch their children. You cannot touch their home. You cannot touch their finances. They are children of God. There's an anointing on their life. There are blessings on their life, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for being our King and our Savior. In Jesus' name, come on, let's give them another standing ovation. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Come on, let's tell the worship team we appreciate them. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Turn around, find a few people, say, I'm glad you're here today. All right. Well, it is good to see you guys. Everybody say, it's good to see me. Go ahead. It's good to see me. All right. Well, it's good to see you, and I'm so happy you guys came. Many of you make it a regular habit to invite guests, and I just want to remind you why we do that. You know, all of our loved ones and our friends, whenever they go through something, we want to help them. And we do the best we can to encourage them, call them whenever they cross our mind. You know, we do the best we can. But I believe we all know that without God in their life, they're going to stay in that season either A, far too long, or they'll never get out of that season. The only way to get out of that season is if the Lord rests their hand on their life. And the only way for them to be aware of Him is if you invite them to the presence of God. And so that is why it is incredibly important. I'll go so far as to say this, that the local church is the hope of the world. Without the local church, people have no hope. And so my challenge is, before the end of the year, invite one person to the house of God. Now, if you are a guest, I want to challenge you. Give us 1 year of your life. Give us 1 year. And I promise you, you'll never be the same again. If you're a guest, on the right-hand side, there is a green table. Just go over there and say hi, and they'll give you a $15 Visa card just for taking a chance on us. You didn't know if you were going to like us, but you came anyway. And so this is for each of you. And Pastor, there is a guy right there with a really cool earring on. He's got a gray shirt. Go ahead and give it to him over there. Go ahead and put your hands together for that. All right. Well, if you're visiting with us today, grab your cell phone, go to your app store, type in Celebration Church TW. You can download our app, and the notes for the message that I'm sharing today are inside of that app. So you can follow along with me. You'll get a lot more out of the service if you do that. But for those of you that call Celebration Church your church home, you've already committed every single area of your life to the Lord. Let me encourage you with this verse. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 8, this is the Lord speaking to the church, which is you. I know all the things that you do, And I have opened a door for you. What does that mean? I've opened a door for new opportunities, new relationships, a greater blessing. I've opened up a door for you that no one can close. Whenever you got opposition, just whisper to yourself, you can't stop this opportunity. You can't stop me from being blessed. Come on, you can't stop it. It's already in motion. It's already happened. Just whisper that to yourself. And then this is what I love from the Lord. You have little strength. He already knows it. He already knows it. It says, you have little strength, yet you obeyed my word. Your flesh is weak. Your faith is weak. But you just keep on obeying. And then he says this, you have not denied me. You did not deny me. So these doors remain open to you, not because you're strong, but because you just keep on obeying. Let me pray for you as you give to the Lord. Lord, we love you. Your eyes go back and forth throughout the whole earth, looking for those who are faithful to you. And Lord Jesus, right now, begin to bless them and show them your strength. In Jesus' name. Real loud, would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, there's so many of you that have tuned in this morning, and we honor you for that. You're not in the room, but you're part of our family. This next round of applause is just for you. Come on, let's give them our best. Thank you for tuning in today. My name's Frankie Mazzapica. The title of today's message is Angels Are Driving the Devil Crazy. Doesn't that sound good? Yeah. Driving them crazy. The enemy tries to drive us crazy, predominantly with the two D's, discouragement, distraction. Discouragement, distraction. Say that with me real loud. Discouragement, distraction. Just two more times real loud. One, two, three. One more time. That's what he does to us. Discouraged, cause us to get depressed. He's always trying to drive us crazy. Well, I want you to know, there are angelic beings that on your behalf drive him crazy. Let me unpack this message for you. It's in Genesis chapter 27 through chapter 33. We see this guy named Jacob. And Jacob has a brother named Esau. It's his older brother. Now, their father, he's lost his vision. And so there is a particular blessing that he reserved for his oldest child. Now, Jacob came in. And he deceived him because his father couldn't see, he deceived him in order to get the blessing that was reserved for his older brother. And so his older brother found out about this, and he was so angry that he set his mind to kill him. Jacob found out about this, and he got on a horse. He grabbed his family, grabbed his wife, grabbed his kids, and just started taking off, running for his life. And so he took a break. In the middle of the night, he laid down. He laid down in the wilderness, and he took a rock, and he rested it on his head. And he went to sleep. The moment that he laid down, the moment that he went to sleep, he had a vision. And the Bible says this in Genesis chapter 28, verse 12. Is that he saw a ladder. Some versions of the Bible, it says a ladder. In other versions of the Bible, it says a staircase. He sees a staircase resting on the earth. and it extended all the way to the heavens. And then he saw angels ascending and descending on the steps. I have three major points for you today. I'm going to talk about how the devil goes crazy when he sees those angels ascending. He goes crazy when he sees the angels descending. And then at the end of the story, or at the end of the season, he goes crazy on how it ends. Despite all the discouragement, despite all the distraction, that when these angels are going up and down, that season always ends well for the children of God. Does anyone love the Lord for that? It always ends well. I'm not going to chase this. It doesn't mean that it is not difficult. It doesn't mean that you don't grit your teeth. It doesn't mean that it's not painful. But what I will tell you is in Romans 8:28, all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord. All things. He takes the good, he takes the bad, he takes the dry seasons, and he mixes it together, and he takes it all. And when you take all of that, you become a stronger person. You begin to call on the Lord like other people do not. You worship different. You have a greater impact in conversations with others. But I just got ahead of myself. Let me go back to the first point. These angels ascending, what are they doing ascending up a staircase? Well, the Bible says in Revelation chapter 5, verse 6, that there are angels of God who carry golden bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. When you pray, there are angels around you that take those prayers and they ascend up a ladder. They go up before God and they present your prayers before the Lord. And it's like a sweet incense before him. Have you ever gone into a room and you're like, this place is disgusting. It smells horrible. And you go get one of those scented candles. It's like cinnamon apple. And you light it and you come back and all of a sudden it's like, oh, thank God. Sometimes you gotta light three or four of them. Here's something interesting about our scent. Have you ever just walked into a room and all of a sudden you smell something? There's a scent in the room and it takes you all the way back to your mother's house or your grandmother's house and you go, this smells like Nana's house. Have you ever been there? Nod your head. I've got a mother in the Lord. I have a mother who's my blood mother, who I love a lot. But I've got another mother of the Lord that just looked at me and said, I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to remind you that there is a call of God on your life. And I'm going to be like a dog with a bone. I am going to remind you and remind you and remind you until you believe it. I'm going to say this. If you want to be effective for God, don't look for a platform, look for a person. Your person and your conversation with them either lifts them up or it pulls them down. There's not a gray area. When you look at somebody and you say, I am assigned to tell you what I believe about you, they will rise to their level of your expectation. But if you say, this is what I believe about you, they will sink to your level of expectation. Discouragement is not a way to motivate. Discouragement is a way to make someone depressed. Are you with me? Say yes. And so I had a mother in the Lord. She would raise it. She would say, Frankie, God has called you for something special. He's called you for something special. And constantly I was like, I think you're wrong. I don't think you know what you're talking about. I know you're older than me. You are wiser than me. But on this one, you're not. Kept bringing it up. Frankie, Frankie, Frankie. And eventually I started to believe her and rise to the expectation. You see, life and death are in the power of the tongue. There's a spirit in our voices. And when you tell somebody that they're here, what you do is you speak curses upon that person, and it closes doors in their life. You push them down. We can see this when children are just little boys and girls, and you see parents talking down to them. And doesn't it break your heart? And why does it break your heart? Because you know what is happening to that child. The Lord told me this a long time ago. When I look at adult women and I look at adult men, we're just kids that have grown up. But our heart is just as tender as it was when we were little. Is that true? Come on, put your hands together. It's true. But when you begin to speak life, you begin to speak life in the supernatural, you start opening up doors. But I say all that to say this, my mother and the Lord wore the same perfume every single day. The name of the perfume is called Pleasures. And I'll never forget it. I can smell it. Sometimes I talk to people in the lobby and they've bathed in the Pleasures. And so I can smell it like 10 feet away. And I know in my mind, she's wearing Pleasures. I can smell it. It's been, it's been a couple decades since I've lived in the same city as her. But I can smell it. And it brings to me it brings back a sweet, enduring moment of my life where I'm endeared to her. This is what happens when these angels present your prayers, your one sentence prayers. Jesus, I love you. 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 And he brings it before the Lord. These angels bring it before the Lord. Never underestimate the power and the significance of one sentence prayers. Never, ever underestimate the significance of that prayer. And so now we understand what they're doing when they ascend up a ladder. But why are these angels coming back down the ladder? What are they doing? Well, when we praises go up, blessings come down. Praises go up. Blessings come down. In Psalms 56:9, it says, the very day you call for help, the tide of the battle turns. The very day. Yes, sir. And God begins to not only answer the prayers that are on your mind and on your heart, but then Ephesians 3:20, he does more than what you can imagine. The more you talk with the Lord, the more you'll say what I often say. Lord, I want you to do what I'm asking for. But there are blessings that are so great, I can't even imagine them, so I can't ask for them. I want those. Yes, sir. Right? I want those. Somebody went to Brazil and they came back and they gave me a box of chocolates. And I promise every single chocolate in that box was a chocolate I had never had before. I am addicted to chocolate. Don't pray for me. I love it. But I have thought, I've had every single kind of chocolate in the world. I've had the box of chocolates like Forrest Gump taught us to do. Every single bite is different. But after a while, nothing is different. He brought this over, and every time I bit into it, I was like, where is this coming? What? Who put this together? Some scientist, some Brazilian scientist. Smoke coming up. Big glasses, huge glasses. White jacket. Smoke. He's coming up with these recipes. I didn't even know that they existed. I couldn't even desire them. I didn't even know they existed. This is what the Lord does. He sends these angels down. Let me encourage you with this thought. There's a lady by the name of Catherine Kuhlman. You have to go all the way back to the 1960s to study her and to learn about her ministry. She was one of the first people to go from city to city and fill stadiums while she spoke about the Lord. Without holding the hands of anyone, hundreds, even thousands of people would get physically healed coming out of wheelchairs. And she said this. She said, if you want to follow the Lord, it will not cost you something. It will cost you everything. It'll cost you the way you talk has to change. The way you dress has to change. The way you think has to change. Every time you're thinking about something, you have to remove and replace. I'm going to tell you what I do. I just start thanking the Lord right then and there. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Oh, it makes the devil so angry. He's trying to shoot arrows into my mind, and all of a sudden I'm worshiping God. It makes him so angry. Oh, he has no authority over our life. You can only think about one thing at a time. Are you with me? Say yes. You say yes. You can't think about two things. I'm sorry, devil. I can't think about what you're putting in my head. I'm thinking about the Lord. So sorry, Ching Chung Charlie. You got to go. So here we go. Devil, you got to go. Everybody say, devil, you got to go. And so these angels come down, and what do they do with Catherine Kuhlman? She's been praying and praying and praying to the Lord. And she makes this note that you have to sacrifice everything. And so when I read that, I was like, wow, that is a really high expectation. And it made me pause until I heard another quote. Somebody was interviewing her, and she said, you must understand that the Holy Spirit, the presence of God, is more real to me than you are. Oh, the cost and the reward. The reward so outweighs the cost. The reward of angels coming down and introducing you to the presence of God. They're coming down with blessings. The only thing you have done is open your mouth and praise Him. The only thing you have done is said a series of one-sentence prayers throughout the day. But the Lord says, you have brought incense before me. Angels have ascended before me with your prayers. Now, angels, thank you. Oh, the prayers of the people. Oh, it smells so good. But now I want you to go down and I want you to bless them. Answer their prayer. In fact, give them some things that I have stored up that they don't even know about. Come on, put your hands together for that. When I say that it'll cost you everything, I was having lunch just this last week, and there were three people at the table. My son was one of them. And we were all laughing about random things. We were having a great lunch. And I thought about this person, and I just thought to myself, I got a really good joke. And so I told the joke. But before I said it, I knew in my heart, don't say this, don't say this. Because the joke wasn't like, you know, what happens when a chicken crosses the road. I was talking about somebody. And I knew it was going to be really funny. But I also knew that if that somebody was at the table, I would not be telling the joke. And so at their expense, I told the joke. Now, immediately, I realized that my assignment, like I told you, is every conversation I have. But then I humiliated myself in front of the people that were at the table. I know that that was wrong. They were laughing at someone else's expense. 48 hours later, I couldn't take it anymore. I sent a text message to everyone that was at the table, and I said, I humiliated myself. I talked about a person behind their back. And I'm very sorry, and I hope that you forgive me. You know, these are the things that it will cost you everything. These certain words that are powerful words, the magic words, are please, I'm sorry, and thank you. Sometimes we pick one of those magic words and say, that one's easy for me. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Look how good I'm doing. There's only three and I got this one down pat. But to be able to say, I'm sorry, that word is so powerful because what you're doing is you're humbling yourself before man. You're humbling yourself before him. Why would we do that? Not because of something. The only reason why that we're doing that is we don't want our words to separate the intimacy before God. And the Bible says this, that he raises up the humble. It's in Luke, what is it? Luke 22:36 says that he raises up the humble and he opposes the proud. When you can no longer say, I'm sorry, be very careful because the Lord, like a football game, you got offense over here, you got defense over here. The Lord is on the other side of the line. All right, let's go on to the next point. That was a little bit heavy. All right, angels coming down, angels going up. When your praises go up, he sends blessings back down. But now let's go back to Jacob. How does this story end? Now, he deceived. He was in the wrong, not Esau. He was in the wrong. Now he's in the middle of a wilderness, not because somebody else did something wrong. See, sometimes we are inflicted with pain. Somebody did something to you. But sometimes we're afflicted. It came from the inside. And so Jacob, Esau was innocent. Jacob was the one that did something wrong. And I say Esau was innocent in that moment. There was a whole bunch of stuff in his life that the Lord hated. But in that moment, it was Esau. Jacob was wrong. And so now he's laying in the middle of the wilderness. He's looking up to God. This is when you're in the wilderness. He's got a rock under his head. But you, I get mad when I have a flat pillow. Are you with me? Say yes. Wave at me if you like flat pillows. Go ahead, wave at me. Okay, let's all, if you see someone who waved, let's all just extend our hand towards them, because that's not normal. You might as well just throw your pillow away. But anyway, he's got a rock under his head. And he's looking up to the Lord, though. In the wilderness, rock under his head. Next time we're in the wilderness with a rock under our head, whether somebody has inflicted us and now we're in the wilderness, or whether or not it was by our own doing, head up, eyes up. And then he has this experience with the Lord. What experience? What was the consequences of that experience? While Esau is chasing him with vengeance dripping off of his lips, the Lord steps in. Prayers went up, blessings come down. Something happens to Esau. It was a miracle. It was beyond what Jacob could have ever imagined. As Esau is getting close, with a sword in his hand, intending on driving it right through Jacob, as he's getting closer, he puts the sword back in its sheath. And his heart, the stony heart, begins to break. You know, in Ezekiel 36:26, it says this, that he will remove a heart of stone and replace it with a heart of flesh. That's what happened to Esau. That's what will happen to your enemies. So here comes Esau, and all of a sudden, tears swell up in his eyes the closer he gets. And all of a sudden, a love towards Jacob begins to fester in his soul. He gets off the horse. Jacob thinks it's over. He runs to him, hugs him, and embraces him. The reconciliation was so powerful. And do you know what it says in Genesis chapter, Genesis chapter 26. I forgot the address. Where Jacob says this. He goes, I did not know that the Lord would be here. I did not know that. It's 28 verse 16. I didn't know he would be here. I didn't know he would be here because I was disobedient. I didn't know he would be there because I'm the one who put me in this tough place. I didn't know he would be there, but he came there. Can I tell you this? When angels go up and then they come back down, they start hunting for you, and they will be exactly where you are. Come on, put your hands together for that. Why don't you stand up on your feet, if you would. You know, this is the moment of the service that you should look at me the way I look at me. My assignment's over. My assignment was to come here, share the word of God with you, and now I have nothing else to say. My assignment's over. It's time for me to walk off the stage. I'm done. And now there's time and space for you to respond. And now the Bible says that just as a man who sees his reflection in the mirror and then turns and forgets what he looks like is just like a person who hears the word of God and turns as if he didn't hear anything at all. This is the moment where you say, God, I love you and I need you. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, it says, when you come into the sanctuary of the Lord, raise holy hands to him. If you want to just raise them this high, that's completely fine. You can raise them higher if you feel comfortable with it. But I just want you to take a minute and fill the golden bowl with some prayers. When you're with people It's okay to pray in your head or in your heart. But in all other times, it's very, very important that you open your mouth and you use your lips and your tongue. Now, people are around you, but the rules are different when you're in the sanctuary. You can raise your voice a little bit, but I don't want you to be so loud that you're going to be a distraction to the person next to you. Or you can put no voice in it at all, to where you can't even hear yourself, but your lips are moving. Do not let the enemy ziplock your lips. Because your heart is willing. The Lord wants it. The only reason why you wouldn't open your mouth is because the enemy has ziplocked your lips. So if all you want to do is just tell the Lord you love him over and over again, it's filling the bowl with incense, and angels will bring it before him. And if you're in this room and you do not know where you would spend eternity if your heart were to stop beating in the next 5 minutes, tell him now, I'm sorry for my sins. You are my Savior, and I will serve you for the rest of my life. So take a moment now. Just close your eyes. Lift your hands and just talk to him for a moment. Holy Spirit, move in this room and do things that no man can do. Just keep talking to him if you would. I'm going to ask the worship team to come on to the stage. There's a sweet presence of the Lord here. And for that reason, I'm going to ask you, let's remain in his presence. Let's just sing this song at least one or two times through. And then you can be dismissed if you'd like. There's no official dismissal. You can leave whenever you want. But let's just sing it one or two times through. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May his face shine down upon you and be gracious to you. May his countenance be lifted up on you and bring you peace. In Jesus' name, amen.